shed a little insight into the mind of the Israeli Prime Minister. Because on that, I'm something of an expert. I have been with the Israeli Prime Minister for 9 years. I've had the privilege to serve with him during that time. He's a man of basic core convictions who has time after time been willing to stand against the current when it was not popular. I was with him in 2000 when Ehud Barak went to Camp David and the entire world applauded. And Netanyahu, much to the chagrin of a lot of Israelis, said that he didn't believe this was going to lead to peace. He said that the willingness to make huge concessions to Yasser Arafat was going to lead to a cascade of terror. That was not popular in Israel in the summer of 2000. And it was not popular in the United States in the summer of 2000. I was with him in 2005, a week before the disengagement, when the entire world was applauding Israel's unilateral withdrawal from Gaza. He resigned his office as finance minister, and he said then that this was only going to be interpreted as a reward for terrorism. It was going to strengthen Hamas, and missiles would land on Ashkelon and Ashdod. He was ridiculed. He was mocked. An election campaign followed 3 or 4 months later that referred to him in this mocking fashion as Israel's prophet of doom. I was with him in 2006 and 2009, the winter of 2008, the beginning of 2009, when Israel had to fight two wars because of that policy of unilateral withdrawal that the world applauded from South Lebanon and from Gaza. And the single greatest opponent of unilateral withdrawal joined the reserves of the State of Israel and became Israel's greatest champion during the war. Now, I was with him a month ago, or 2 months ago, when he decided to form a unity government. After a very, very difficult election campaign, he reached out to his political opponents and decided that Israel's challenges were too great to just have half the country lead the process. He reached out, and thankfully, the Defense Minister, Ehud Barak, joined him, and today Israel has a national unity government. Now, I've been with him for the last 9 years when day after day, month after month, year after year, he has warned the world about the nuclearization of Iran. You've probably heard him say it over and over and over again, and he has not lost sight on what's most important. Now, I say this, all this, because everyone wants to know, at least I get asked all the time, who is Benjamin Netanyahu? Is he going to be the guy who's going to make peace? Is he going to be the guy who, did he learn anything from past mistakes? Is he ready to lead Israel? Well, I'll tell you this. Netanyahu told me many years ago that his greatest mistake as prime minister was to not form a unity government. The single greatest mistake, he should have turned to Peres in 1996, and Peres was, shockingly, willing to join his government at the time, and that, he said, was his greatest mistake. And last month, he corrected that mistake. It was very difficult to do it, believe me. Had to make a very, very, very big government. But he decided he was going to form a national unity government. And as for whether he is ready to lead, I can't think of anyone who is more suitable to lead Israel at this time. Zev Jabotinsky said that the virtue of the statesman is prescience, his ability to see future events. I don't believe anyone in Israel has the track record that our prime minister has of recognizing the dangers facing the country. And this is critical because we have lived through years and years and years of illusions. And I agree with Aaron. We definitely need prudence, and we need a sober approach. What has changed is not necessarily Netanyahu, who I think still has that gift. What has changed is the environment in which he operates today. In 1996, when Netanyahu was elected, half of the Israeli public thought he was the obstacle to peace. The entire international community thought he was the obstacle to peace. And the Clinton administration, who sincerely believed that peace was around the corner, thought that he was the obstacle to peace. If we could just get a few more concessions out of Israel, we could get peace. That is no longer the case today. Today, Israelis do not believe that the problem is a lack of willingness to make concessions on their part. They no longer believe that. What they see on the Palestinian side is that half the Palestinian body politic has been taken over by Hamas. The other half has very little capacity to enforce anything. Now, there have been signs in the last few months, maybe a year, that they are developing some capacity to enforce the rule of law. It's limited, but they're developing it. But we still don't see that they're actively fighting against terrorism. Now, the half of the Palestinian polity who is not openly dedicated to Israel's destruction, openly dedicated to the murder of Jews, as Hamas is, they are unwilling to recognize Israel as a Jewish state. And they say so openly, we will never recognize Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people. For those of you who think that this has anything to do with the refugee issue, you're wrong. In 1947, there wasn't a single refugee, and the Palestinians and the Arab world was not willing to recognize a nation state for the Jewish people. That is a core issue, the core issue, and they say openly they will never agree with it. And finally, you have, among the half of the Palestinian body politic who is engaging with us and wants to engage with us in peace, you have the continued indoctrination and incitement against the state of Israel. So I'm going to surprise you all today, and I'm going to tell you that the Prime Minister of Israel, far from being a prophet of doom, actually believes that peace is possible. Now, how can this possibly be the case? It's possible for three reasons. First, it's possible because he was elected. What does that have to do with anything? He's obviously very optimistic that he got elected. But it's possible because he was elected to lead Israel down a different path. The days of continuing down the same path of weakness and capitulation and concessions, hoping that somehow the Palestinians would respond in kind, are over. Israelis voted for change. The victory in Israel, by the way, you may not know, we have a different system. If you look at this shift in Israeli politics, the parties of the Likud to the right won 65 seats. It's a bigger victory than Barack Obama had in the United States. And if you take the Arab parties out of the equation, it's actually a bigger victory than almost any president in U.S. history has ever had. There's a huge shift in Israeli public opinion. Israelis do not want to go down the same path. That's the first reason.